Welcome everybody. Hope you're having a good day, and I hope you find that this session is informational as well as very inspiring, and maybe to give you a little bit of a different perspective on what a personal brand is. And I want to get into a little bit about how to uncover yours, and the handouts that I gave you today are a few exercises that I use, but I use many more than that, but we'll touch on these. So how to uncover yours. I'm going to talk a little bit about the science behind the connection and how that all works. It has to do with the brain and the heart and how you connect to others. And then some tips and techniques that you can implement now and really jumpstart your business and help you to connect with clients, get more of what you want. You only have 7 seconds to make a strong first impression, at least by several articles that I saw out there on the web, including Forbes magazine. In fact, there was one article that I saw that it's in the blink of an eye when you meet someone that they almost make a preconceived judgment or get an impression in like a tenth of a second. And I know that on the web these days, that your website is just as fast. Like, you have to get someone's attention in like 3 seconds or else they're gone, and we can all see the bounce rates in our Google Analytics, I'm sure. There's a lot of components that go into that impression, and then how do you make a lasting impression? How can you control how others perceive you in that time frame? It really is all wrapped up in your personal brand. We all have one, and essentially your brand is you. Okay, we're done. Not quite. So a couple of quotes that I love around what a brand is, and a personal brand in particular. Your brand is the story of your truth, what you stand for and what you promise, and what people experience. And another quote, we're always impacting the world in which we live through our presence, our energy, and our own interactions with others. So let's talk celebrity brands for a minute. So when you look at any or all of these people, I would say any, if there's any in particular, that you resonate with, what do you think of when you see one of these brands? And you can shout out an answer, and I'll repeat it into the mic for purposes of recording today. So if you look at someone like Tom Brady, or any sports fans in the room? All right, what do you think of when you think of Tom Brady?
Very dedicated, works really hard.
Dedicated and works really hard. What was
Successful.
That?
Successful.
Successful. How about someone like Ellen?
Down to earth.
Down to earth.
Funny.
Funny.
Fun.
Fun. Genuine, I'd throw that in. I mean, she comes down to earth, genuine. That's a good, another good analogy. How about Maya Angelou?
Wise.
Really cool. Thank you. She's inspired me, and all of these people have inspired me in many ways. Oprah.
Success.
Success. Why? Why do you think she's successful? Anything in particular you think that in her, the way she comes across to people?
Ambitious but warm.
Ambitious but warm. Anything else?
Motivational.
Motivational. Charismatic, savvy, and smart.
Empathetic.
Empathetic.
Yes.
Good one. Good one. So how do we know all these? Like, how do we get that sense about them? That's really all about their personal brand. And for me, I feel like all of these represent strong examples of authentic personal brands. And today, with news and media and everything that we get bombarding us, we tend to resonate more with the authenticity. We're seeing through the fakeness. We're seeing through the inauthentic presentations of people's brands. So I say that a brand, a personal brand, is the perception you create and the connection that you make through things like your energy, your passion, your appearance, your body language. I had an example of a panel that it had nothing to do with this event. It was a panel that it was in my town where they were talking about how to work together and who wanted to get the town's selectmen to work together. And there was a gentleman that said, I really think that I'm going to be open to hearing everybody's opinion. And he was sitting at the table literally with his hand across his face, and I started laughing to myself. Because if that wasn't body language that totally contradicted what he said, I don't know what was. It includes your personality, it includes emotions, it includes your belief system, and your values. Where does it show up? Well, it shows up everywhere. It's really, you walk around with your personal brand. So it's in your face-to-face, at networking events, in your workplace. Like, how do you connect with others, and where do you fit in the structure of your workplace? Your online presence, obviously, is a huge one these days between social media and websites and really wherever you show up online. It can show up in your resume. I work with some clients in beefing up their LinkedIn profiles and their resumes. And, you know, what's going to make them attractive? How does their passion come through in things like that? And in marketing communications, if you have your business, it's really, if it's your business, if several people in the room said that they have their own business, if it's your business brand is really reflective of who you are. So a little bit about the science. I call it the heart brain. Well, there's something called heart math, and you can Google it and check it out, that your heart has more sensory neurons than your brain does. So that when people meet you, they could be sensing more the energy coming from your heart. And they can measure that now with scientific instruments. They can literally measure it. Now, I don't know about you, but I've certainly had the experience where somebody walks in the room, they're in a bad mood, they haven't even opened their mouth, they haven't slammed a door, you can feel they're in a bad mood. How do we feel that? We're feeling their energy. The opposite is true. If you're in a really good mood, and you're really bubbly, and you haven't even said a word, or somebody walks in the room, you can sense that. Well, you can sense it because it's coming from the heart energy, more so than the head energy. But there is some science around the brain, too. And Simon Sinek is someone that I've fallen in love with in the sense of how he talks about the connection to the brain. And the outer part of the brain is the neocortex, and that's really the rational part of the brain. It's where all of your senses are taking in information around you. It's where your language comes from. The limbic brain is the inner part of the brain, and it's where your emotions come from, your trust comes from, and decision-making comes from, but it's not where your language comes from. So it's when you have that gut feeling or gut reaction about someone or something, that's because it's coming from the limbic brain. Or when you're talking to someone about something that either you love so much, but you can't even put the words to it because you're so excited about it, like you can't even get the words out. That's because it's coming from the limbic brain. So if you connect the part about the fact that your heart has more sensory neurons, and that the limbic brain is where you're going to make the connection to, a stronger connection to people, because if you're tapping into their emotions, and that's where the decision making comes from, you have to make some sort of a connection on a deeper level. So Simon goes on to say that the outer part of the brain can relate to things like, everybody knows what they do. You meet someone and they say, what do you do? Well, you know, I'm an accountant, or I'm a banker, or I do WordPress. Some people know what they do, that kind of gets start, how they do it, I'm sorry, gets into the next level of, or the outer part of the limbic brain, and that's where sometimes you hear, like, unique selling propositions if you have a business and you're working on marketing language. And then the very inner part is the why, and if you can, again, I'm not going to do Simon's talk for him, but he does a great explanation of the why. And I relate the why to the core, so sort of that core aspect of what's coming from you and your heart. So I developed a process called the core process, and it's got four components. It's connecting with who you are, which is really connecting to your story. It's optimizing the path, and that's really looking at who are you trying to connect with on a daily basis in your business, in just your personal surroundings. Reach beyond is about how you reach them and then reaching beyond your comfort zone. And then energizing the connection, and we just talked about the energy. So starting with connecting with who you are, you need to stop for a minute and take a little quiet time to be. We're always on the treadmill, we're going a million miles an hour. We don't even take the time to figure out, what am I passionate about? What do I love to do? Why am I not being so happy in my workplace if I'm in a work situation? There are Gallup statistics out there that say that 70% of the U.S. population, or the U.S. workforce, is unhappy or unmotivated in their work. That's a huge number. So that's why there are a lot of people starting their own businesses. They want to connect to something that they are excited about. So I work with clients and say, you know, tune into your body. Be aware of how you feel when you're doing something you love. It doesn't even have to be your work. It could be, because if you're not happy at work, you want to connect and think about, what is it that I do love? What do I enjoy? What makes you click, and how do you unlock that passion? And look at who you are authentically. So I gave you some handouts. We won't have time to actually do the exercises today, but hopefully you can walk away with them and play around with them. And if you didn't get one, come up after, and I'll give you, I'll take your name, and I'll send the PDF to you. But take that time to figure out, like, tune into that energy. And then when you're working on language or marketing copy or any of that, you kind of refer back to that feeling so that you should have that when you're talking to people about the work that you're doing, whether it's your own business or whether it's just something you're passionate about. Passion's contagious. You want to connect with them. You want to connect with core values, and we'll dive into that in a second, as well as your vision. Like, what do you want? Like, what do you want for your business? What do you want in your life? What are your philosophies around life, and what are your beliefs? Where's your unique brilliance? How do you shine, and what areas do you shine in your work? Like, a lot of times I'll be working with a client and look at, what are the aspects of their job that they really enjoy? Oftentimes, there's a creative piece that they haven't really been able to nurture or fulfill, and they've lost sight of it along the way because of that. But sometimes you can infuse some of those things and more of that into the work and things that you're doing. But all of these are pieces of what make up you and your brand. You can incorporate highlights and lowlights, like looking back in your career or in your life, and look at those pieces that make up you and incorporate that into pieces of your personal brand. And then I call it the credibility vulnerability issue, and we'll talk about the balancing act in a minute. But that's about balancing your credible side, such as your experience, your credentials, with the vulnerable side, that personal side of you that people need to see a little bit of, not too much, to connect. Intuition can help you find the information you need too, both about yourself as well as your market, to make a difference and profit by being yourself. I mean, that's what it's all about here. It's about not only being able to thrive in your work, but to make a difference as well. 99% of the clients that I work with say, I want to help, I just want to help people. Whatever aspect of the work that you do, it always comes around to that, it seems. So why are core values important? When you align with core values, your own, and then those in some form or fashion align, say you work for a company, if they align with that company, you're more likely to have a thriving work environment, you're more likely to be happier in that area because you're really connecting at the core. There's something about where you work or the work, even the work that you want to do in your own company, in your own business, there's something that ties into your core values. Even people you connect with at work or people that you hire, like some kind of deeper level connection to the core values. They really, they become very important. They can be the strength and the foundation, and it can make a connection much stronger. So the second worksheet that's in there is about core values, and if we have time at the end, we'll revisit this and we'll go back to it. But the idea here is to, it's a very short list, is to go through it and to look at, circle the ones that resonate with you as being really, really important to you and that you can't live without. And not just on the surface, like, oh, this is what I'm good at, or this is, you know, something, the way I've been my whole life. It's like, why? Why have you been that way your whole life? Or why is that important to you? Why is being, I'm looking at, brilliant important to you? Or what is dependable is another one that people always say, dependable, well, why is that important to you? And where did it come from? And why does it matter? And so it's pulling out pieces of that so that you can incorporate it later into the overall arching brand. I mentioned what's your vision. Now, I don't know how many of you are old enough in the room to know Fantasy Island, but it's a fun TV show, and it's still on one of those channels that shows some of the older shows. But you want to play on Fantasy Island a little bit and have some fun with it and look at what is your vision. What's the vision for you and for yourself? If you don't know the show, people would go to this island and pay to go there to live out a fantasy, whether it was being in a particular type of work or whatever it was. But get clear on what jazzes or excites you and foster your creativity and nurture your passion. Typically when I work with a client and creating their personal brand, we end up with what we call a personal brand manifesto. And that can take many forms. If I'm working with a client for a business, we often get into more descriptive terms around a manifesto, such as using those core values and building on them because they then in turn become marketing copy, beliefs, statements, and another exercise that I use that is called a so what exercise, and we'll touch a little bit on that in a second. But if you're doing this for yourself, just as your own personal manifesto, it's what is your soapbox? What do you stand for in your life? And it can take any kind of form. If you have a creative side and you want to get it out, you want it on the wall, you want it somewhere in front of you to remind you, if you've gotten off track, to get back to it and to remember that these are the things that you really stand for. Now, optimizing the path. Think about it. On a day-to-day basis, everyone is your target audience. So you could be getting coffee from someone at Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts, and they're your target audience in that moment. How are you interacting with them? If you go to work and you have colleagues around you, they're your target audience. If you have your own business and you need clients, then they're your target audience. We all have them moment to moment, and they change moment to moment. Who are they? What's going on with them? What is their perspective? You have to start to get in their heads a little bit. Like, what's going on with their life? Sometimes I challenge myself to make the kid at the cash register at the supermarket smile, because they're like this behind the cash register and like just not even interacting with people. We lose connection. I know we all have our devices, and we get so connected to our devices. They're showing Simon Sinek does another talk on devices. We get so addicted to our devices, and we think we're connected to people, but we're not. We're, in fact, isolating ourselves more and more because we should have those face-to-face conversations with people instead of texting somebody. But thinking about that, it is about making connection. Can you have compassion and understanding for the person on the other side? If you're working in a corporate setting, can you have compassion for your boss? I had a client recently who said that was the biggest thing that helped her, was to realize, you know, my boss is a person too, and my boss has issues and struggles and family life and deadlines to meet and numbers to hit. And can you take that into consideration and have a little bit of compassion and understanding for who's on the other side of your conversation, of your interaction? What do they need from you? How do you help them? What's in it for them? What is the value that you bring? Do you know what your value is? Can you communicate that to people? But think about what keeps them awake at night, too, because that's going to help to foster a connection. If you can understand what keeps them awake at night and they have a problem and you can solve it, then you can help to make a connection very quickly and help to provide a solution for them. Put yourself in their shoes. What do you have in common with them? Do you have similar beliefs or values? Where do you align? You can create profiles if you have a business or you're starting a business. Think about who your target audience is and create a rough profile of what you think your target audience is. And not just the demographics, and which can include, you know, age or gender or whatever those things are, financial, incorporating their financial demographics and all of that, but go beyond that. Think about, what do they need? Do you have similar beliefs or values? Where do you align? That's where you're going to make the connection. When you make those, create those profiles, then you can start to see where the connections are. All right, I threw this in to get everybody. Let's see if you're awake still. So, the pet connection, I talk about that a lot because a lot of people can relate to it. How many people in here have pets? All right. You all love your pets, I know. They become part of the family. I can't tell you how many times I've been at a networking event or whatever. This little guy I just adopted about a month and a half ago. And you mention something, and people start whipping out their smartphones and saying, oh, look at the picture of my dog or my cat or something like that. But think about it. You just made a connection with someone on a deeper level. First of all, they love their pets, just like you. They nurture their pets. They become part of the family. The pet industry is huge. Like, people spend millions of dollars on their pets. So you can start to make some assumptions that they have similar core values to you. They have a nurturing sense around animals. They might care about the environment. I don't know. But you start to open conversation just by finding that commonality. And it can be kind of fun, too. So we connect with others by identifying common dreams and shared passions. Shared vision, emotional connection, and complementary strengths are the key to success in any business. So I mentioned briefly before the unique brilliance piece of it. When you identify what your unique brilliance is, and then you look at things that you don't like to do so much, and you find people that love to do the things that you don't like to do so much, and they really don't like to do the things that you love, then you put those together, and that's when you really can find make a successful connection, and then also have success in your business. So reach beyond. Who are you now, and who do you want to be? You need to value others, and really seek out those that align with you. Especially if you're marketing yourself, you don't want to try to market everyone. I know I just went to one of the sessions, and they were talking about find your niche. If you can find your niche, well, your niche should be based on those things that you love, those values that you have, those beliefs that you have. Don't try to be friends with everybody. You want to connect with the people that you have something in common with, because that's going to form a stronger bond. If you're targeting people for a business and you want more clients, when you have that stronger bond, statistics show that they will spend on average 20% more with you, like on an ongoing basis. And I know the gentleman that was talking about finding the niche also said that when you show someone that you care about them and you care about their business, they're going to keep coming back and you can sell them more stuff. But it's not about just selling, it's about just being who you are and what you believe in. So it makes the whole sales process so much easier too. But you need to put yourself out there, and you can either take baby steps or really take a leap. Does your outside match your inside? There are people out there that are image consultants. I'm not one of them. But sometimes your appearance can play a role in what you're trying to do and what you want to achieve. What's the impression, that first impression that you're making? If you're going into a business and a client that you want as a potential client, how are you showing up? Are you showing up in a way that's going to relate to them, going to connect to them, that they can connect with you, that they can build trust with you? You need to think about sending the right message. Now, obviously, your online image is really important, so you need to beware. Sometimes people see or find out more about you than you think they do. They might be coming to see your Facebook account or whatever. Are you being conscious of what's there? That's the balancing act. You know, you want to give them some sense of who you are and what you stand for, but you don't want to alienate people, really. You want to connect with the people that you want to connect with without really pushing everybody else away. You want to develop a voice. It goes back to that, what do you stand for? What do you believe in? What are your core values? All of those things can go into developing a voice. If you're blogging, if your website is reflecting who you are as a business, what's your viewpoint? What do you do for others? How do you solve problems? Create that voice. It needs to be authentic. People do not like being sold to these days. Sales pitches, the old-fashioned sales pitches, really don't work. I know for me, if somebody tries to sell me something and they're doing it the old-fashioned way, I'm already like backing up. Passion is contagious, and I can't help saying that enough. When you're passionate about something and you show that passion, people connect with it. And the other worksheet that I gave you, and you can work on this on your own, is the credibility vulnerability piece. And that's when you can put some things down that are your credentials and the experience that you bring to a situation, or as I said, if you're going for clients. And then balance that with some things that dive a little bit deeper into the personal side of things. And why should they care? What is it about that that's going to connect with them on a deeper level? What problems are you solving? How can you go deeper than the rational problem? Can you dive into an emotional problem? You can ask the question, so what? I use that a lot. So if you say, all right, I provide WordPress websites for my clients. Well, so what? What does that mean to them? Well, that can help them for their business. Okay, so what? Well, what does that mean to them? Well, that means that they can provide for their family. Well, okay, so what? What does that mean to them? Well, then their children are more well taken care of, or whatever. But you get the idea that going a little bit deeper can help you to see what that personal connection is. How can you help? Can you go into a meeting thinking, instead of thinking, I need this client, or I need this job, or out of a feeling of desperation, and go in there and say, thinking in your head, how can I help? How can I help this person? I know what I have to offer provides a solution. So how can I help this person? Now, if you feel in your body, go back to the beginning when I was saying feel in your body when you feel good about something or not. You can feel a shift in your body if you're thinking you're going into a meeting saying, I need this client, I'm desperate, I need business, I need to build my business, versus, how can I help this person? Like, you're just more relaxed. And one of my clients experienced that and said, yeah, you know, I'm more relaxed, I'm more open to possibilities. And I said, well, don't you think the person on the other side of the table wants to be more open to possibilities? That's why they're coming to you. They need help with something. Why does what you have to offer matter to them, whether it's you as an individual or you as a business? Think about the good viral versus the negative viral. When something goes viral, it's because people have connected with it on some sort of an emotional level. That's the only reason why they pass it on. They've made some good connection with it. I don't really believe in the negative viral stuff, so I think that we all need to focus more on what's positive and what resonates with us in a good way. E is about energizing the connection, and we talked about that at the beginning as far as the energy piece of it, but you have to think about the science and remember about the brain and the heart. So remember that limbic brain thing. You're really shooting to connect with someone on a limbic brain level, but they're not necessarily going to be able to communicate back to you that you made that connection. It's more of a subliminal connection. Be mindful of that heart energy, just as I was describing. Are you going in there with stress and anxiety into a meeting? Take a couple of minutes to take a breath before you go into a meeting. I had a corporate situation where I gave this talk, and one of the high-level executives came up to me afterwards and said, you know, I really resonated with what you said about walking in there with the right energy. She said that happened to me when I had a really big meeting that I had to go into, and I didn't check in with myself before I went into the meeting, and it was disastrous. She said that connected with me so much, and it's so true. So to take a minute, all it takes is a minute. You know, breathe, engage your core, just be authentic. So this may seem simple, but your brand is you. Connect to your core. Remember to be authentic. Remember the science. Connect to your target audience. How you want to be seen and perceived. Send the right message. And you make the impact that you want to make. And it really is all about making an impact and making a difference. There wouldn't be any reason for doing all of this if it wasn't for that. Remember, you only have 7 seconds or less to make a strong first impression. There really is power in your authentic brand. And connection, I believe, is the catalyst to accelerate your success. Where are we on time?
8 minutes.
8 minutes, okay. So that's the end of my formal part. So I wanted to jump back to the core value exercise. So if you all want to take a second to look at that exercise, and I'll give you 2 minutes to circle the ones that resonate with you, and I'd love to use a couple of examples so that we can get a little bit into how powerful connecting with those can be. So I'll give you 2 minutes. Sunday afternoon, I guess. I'm not sure there would be so many people coming, which is awesome. One more minute. We'll do a couple of examples. This is a really short list, so that if you have something else resonates with you much more than that, then certainly write that down. All right, so who would like to be brave enough to share one of their core values? Anybody? Come on. All right, right here.
You just want one?
One for now. We'll start.
Okay. I
compassionate.
Yep.
Okay. So why is that a core value for you?
sort of a combination of empathy and insight, I think.
Okay.
And so it's I think it's a core value because it's just important to me to care about other beings and to consider them. And I think it manifests like in how I run my business and my politics and just, you know, my hobbies and like what causes I contribute to.
Okay.
Like my spiritual life. It's just like all runs throughout everything.
Okay. All right. Do you know where that comes from? Do you know if someone had an influence on you when you were younger or?
I think it's almost a reaction to not finding enough compassion when I was younger mm-hmm. and developing it because it was lacking.
Okay. So you had already said that it's integrated into your work and how you approach work. So I would imagine that people that you form a stronger connection with through your work must have some essence of compassion in there.
Yeah, I mean, I specifically work with mission-driven organizations.
There you go. Okay.
And I even if I work with somebody else, I have to connect with their raison d'etre.
So if you're promoting yourself or your business, then you want to make sure that in some, you may not use even the word compassion, but maybe you would, there's a way that you would integrate that into your marketing language and marketing copy, and also to connect that to why that is beneficial to people. So you can start to see why taking a core value could be a really strong way to even build a whole marketing and brand platform in a business. There was somebody else that was willing to share their, share one.
Me? Oh, okay. Collaborative is the word I like.
Okay, and why do you like that word?
Well, because I am a creative and I like to work with others to come together to some solution. I mean, design is always solving a problem. Mm-hmm. So my clients, I'm trying to incorporate them into whatever we're working towards, whatever the design goal is.
Okay. All right. And if you don't have collaboration, what happens?
Well, then it becomes about me more than the other, you know. So the result, while it may be professional and what I think is a good solution, may not really reflect my client. So I prefer to have collaborative people to work with them.
Okay. So that is really key, and what I'm hearing, too, is that contributes to stronger solutions
yes.
overall.
Yeah, definitely does.
Right. So, obviously, that would be really important to incorporate in your marketing language.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, when you look at all of these pieces, and you want to be able to leverage that in all of your communications, so if you're creating a website or you're creating clients' websites, you know, instead of just saying welcome on the homepage, is there a way to integrate something that's going to connect with people on a stronger level than just saying welcome and welcome to our site? You know, you've got 3 seconds to make that connection to people. Are there any questions before we wrap up? I know we're done here. So, any questions? Okay, well, I hope this was inspiring and helpful for you. And thank you for coming, and enjoy the rest of your day.